Yeah. It's gonna get serious. You at the barbecue. It's got good beer. Now you're eating ribs and chicken. And we up here sweating. And God is good to you. Tell me something. I said, tell me something. He said, it's a new season.
Yes.
Good enough right there.
That's good.
He said, it's a new season.
It's a new season.
Now, he did what all people do. He said, you didn't hear what I said. He said, it's a new season.
Yes.
You didn't hear what I said. He said, you think I'm telling you it's an old season that's been recycled. Summertime is not a new season because it's been summertime before. Christmas time is not a new season because it's been Christmas time before. He told me to tell you it's a new season, not just an old season recycled. And I can tell by some of your responses that you think this is just the old same thing that I've heard 10,000 times, but I'm telling you today, it's a new season. And you know what new season means? New season means new rules. You've been living on that paycheck long enough. You've been living on that fixed income long enough. I'm going to tell you the name of the season that it's over. This is a season called abundance.
This is the season.
minister said, you have entered into a new season. And when you wake up tomorrow, you will officially be in the second half of 2021. And if you watch sports, sometimes you got first half teams, but everybody wants to be a part of a second half team because that's when the money is made. And we know that God has something great in store for you in the second half of this year. We're so grateful to God for the opportunity to be with you today. I'm Pastor Joe. We are Refuge Church of God in Christ. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. We indeed bring you greetings from our senior leaders, Superintendent Joseph Williams and his lovely wife, First Lady Brenda Williams. I greet you from my wife, and we're just thankful that God has seen fit to allow us to be with you on the first Sunday in July. And we know that God has a word for his people. From the 22nd book of Acts, we're going to begin reading at verse number 24. The chief captain commanded him to be brought into the castle and bade that he should be examined by scourging, that he might know wherefore they cried so against him. And as they bound him with thongs, Paul said unto the centurion that stood by, Is it lawful for you to scourge a man that is a Roman and uncondemned? When the centurion heard that, he went and told the chief captain, saying, Take heed what thou doest, for this man is a Roman. And the chief captain came and said unto him, Tell me, art thou a Roman? Paul said, Yea. And the chief captain answered, With a great sum obtained I this freedom. Paul said, But I was freeborn. And straightway they departed from him which should have examined him. The chief captain also was afraid after he knew that he was a Roman, and because he had bound him. On the morrow, because he would have known the certainty whereof he was accused of the Jews, he loosed him from his bands and commanded the chief priest and all their council to appear, and brought Paul down and set him before them. And the word of the Lord is indeed rich, it is powerful, and it is blessed. Our thought for today is, let me go, I was born free. Let me go, I was born free. Father, we are simply because you are our God. And as such, you are our provider. You have provided and prepared a word for your people. Prepare now your people to receive your word. And let the words of my mouth, meditations of my heart be found acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, my strength, rock, and redeemer. Amen. Before stated, most of us are aware that today is Sunday, July 4th, 2020. And to everyone listening to me, I trust that you are enjoying the holiday where we celebrate the red, the white, and the blue. Independence Day, so-called, is the day that we celebrate the idea and concept of freedom, liberty, and justice for all. And if that was the day when the 13 colonies declared independence from the control of Great Britain. That was the day when America became a sovereign nation by choosing to break away from the tyranny, the taxes, and the tight grip of the authority being exercised over it. However, there is great irony in this day and the founding document that accompanies it. And that is, while Thomas Jefferson aptly and almost sacredly penned in the Declaration of Independence that we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, he did so while he owned slaves. And the nation would operate with American chattel slavery as the rule of law for nearly 90 more years. That fact alone would, in my opinion, be foundational enough to at least take a look at the idea of critical race theory. But there are still a great number of people that are too scared of reality and would much rather live in a world of cognitive dissonance and plausible deniability because, as the old saying goes, the truth hurts. While scores of people are crying for the veil to finally be lifted, first from the eyes, then secondly from the bank accounts and coffers of our nation's financial institutions to make the serious repair, reparations for the insurmountable damage that has been inflicted upon millions of black people by white people, not much real verifiable change has taken place still. Independence Day, maybe above any other day on the calendar, proves that no matter how well-crafted, highly intelligent, and timeless one's words may be, they ring deafeningly hollow if they are not accompanied by equal action and follow through. And what we are seeing playing right out before our eyes are apologies without action, are protests without power, and are holidays without significant help. I find it is here that I must recognize the importance of Juneteenth becoming a national holiday for the very first time in American history. But I also must ask you to do me a great favor. Go find your umbrella emojis and begin posting them now. Because, yes, we appreciate our government doing the right thing. We are also here to let them and the world know you will not pee on our heads and try to convince us that it is raining. Here is your first hashtag, do the right thing. Don't give us no holiday and don't give us any money. Do the right thing by stopping the right wing from changing the voting laws in states controlled by their legislatures. Do the right thing by sending everyone, including former President Donald J. Trump, to jail for the insurrection on January 6th, 2021. Do the right thing. We are not mad at the COVID-19 hate crimes bill that was specifically birthed to protect Asian Americans from the violence that has come via the idiots of Trump's America. But can we at least get a federal bill that touts police reform? Can you explain to me why we still yet in 2021 do not have any federal anti-lynching legislation still? Emmett Till died in 1955, and yet in America, we're going to protect the Asians from the potential hate, but yet still do not have any federal anti-lynching legislation. And may I ask the last question, finally, where is our money? The United States of America found money for bailouts for the banks. They found money to bail out the automobile industry. We found money so that half of the country could sit around doing nothing, eating crab legs and shrimp, but we have never found one red cent to give to African Americans for all of the pain, suffering, and stress that we are yet still living in and from, of all of the atrocities enacted upon us. And I find it real fitting right now to quote the words of Claire Huxtable. We want our money and we want it now. If you want your money, post some dollar signs in the comments. And so while we are having hot dogs and hamburgers and ribs, we have to do so with sobriety and understand that Independence Day and racism seem to go hand in hand and make very strange bedfellows. But what if I told you that as much as the book of Acts is about the power of the Holy Spirit, about the birthing of the Christian church and the genesis of the church age, racism or anti-racism is a very prominent theme that is also interwoven throughout the book of Acts. You find God coming directly against the sin of racism. You ain't never heard nobody tell you that before, but as we come into our text, you're going to find how God deals with racist behavior. We find that the Apostle Paul has been placed in a very precarious position. Now, interestingly enough, it is a position that he chose to be in to a large degree. He has gone to Jerusalem, which one would think for a Jew would be a safe place to be. It was not so for Paul. He had been warned, however, at least three different times in chapter 21, as recorded, that he should not go in to Jerusalem. He had a number of witnesses from all walks of life tell Paul, if you go back home, you're going to encounter some serious trouble. But Paul, being the stubborn man of God that he was, he went anyway, finding the possibility of suffering for Christ being worth more than the safety of staying where he was. There was a mantra of the head coach of the Super Bowl champion Tampa Bay Buccaneers that iterates, no risk it, no biscuit. What we say in the hood is scared money don't make no money. You get the point. What Paul was trying to let everybody know is that if you play scared, you have all already lost. And some things are worth leaving safety and security for. And for Paul, he was obsessed with being able to advance the cause of Christ and felt like he would die for it than live outside of it. And so in the face of trouble, Paul went anyway. In the face of uncertainty, he went anyway. In the face of peril, look, he went anyway. And if you read the text, you will find that as he comes into Jerusalem, everything was smooth sailing. He was greeted by the saints who welcomed Paul and the testimony that accompanied him. And they begin to give Paul their own testimony. Paul told them of how God used him and converted him to the place where he could minister to the Gentiles. They begin to talk to Paul about how God was using them to minister to the Jews. However, the tension that drives this particular story forward was that while both were converted into followers of Jesus Christ, the Jewish converts became zealous for Jesus and their Jewishness, their nationality, traditions, and culture. And as a result, Paul was basically a wanted man, and they were angry at Paul for his connections to the Gentiles, those people that were not Jews. I need you to catch this. Now, per the advice of the men he came to see, Paul tried to avoid potential danger by appealing to the xenophobic nature of the Jewish culture. But when he went into the temple and was recognized, all they could see was the man that they felt violated their nationalism. Going to find that as part of Paul wanting to fit in with the Jewish nationals, that Paul and the other men with him shaved his head. He shaved his head in humility and connected with some other shaven head Jews, meaning that Paul became a skinhead, trying to prove that he was a devout follower of Jewish nationalism. But would you not know that for the Jewish people, it simply was not enough? He was a Gentile lover, and the Jewish community was determined to make him pay. Before we get to the end, please allow us to allow Paul's life to speak some significant lessons for us today. Lesson number one: stop busying yourself trying to appease people who will never see you for what you are and will only recognize you for what you were. Put this in your mind and tell yourself, if you cannot get past my past, then you don't deserve a place in my future. There are things that I've done, you've done, we've done in the past that are not relevant to our present and certainly will not limit or determine our futures. But if you can't get over it, it sounds like a you problem. It's no longer on me. Paul spent his time trying to appease people who were only going to see him for what he was. But what you need to also understand is point number two. If God says you are headed into a time of trouble, you cannot avoid that which God has said. No need to try to circumvent it, because it is definitely coming. But I need you to hear, there's a latent shout that somebody already caught contained with what I just said. Because all I told you was whatever God said already is. So if he said there will be trouble, there will be trouble. But if God says there will be a blessing, the enemy cannot affect what he says. There will be a blessing. If he says healing, there will be healing. If he says favor, restoration, and prosperity, nothing can stop what God is sending your way. So after Paul was recognized, the Bible lets us know he was captured and was going to be killed. But as I am sure you can probably imagine, great commotion and confusion began to take place, because he's drawing so much attention that the city wants to kill Paul. The confusion, consequently, was the thing that stayed their impending judgment. You've heard the phrase, the battle is not yours, it is the Lord's. That text comes via the story of when Jehoshaphat led Israel into victory. And the Bible teaches us that as they praised God, God confused the enemies. You see, sometimes confusion is a viable weapon in the defense and victory of the believer. And in this case, all the confusion did was provide Paul the opportunity to speak and tell his testimony in his native tongue. I need to preach to about 19 people. You need to understand that when confusion arises in your life, your testimony is a great weapon, because it simply proves if God did it before, he can certainly do it again. If he settled the score, settled me down, settled the matters that crept in before, because he is Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever, he can do it again. So I need you to hear that Paul is talking to the citizens in his native language. This appeased their attitudes towards him. And as you read the text, you'll find that as long as he spoke to them, there was calm. They had no issue with anything that Paul was saying, even though they were fundamentally opposed to many of the concepts to which he was espousing. And so right around verse 21, the story takes a great twist in that the calm turns into rage when Paul tells them, essentially, and I'm paraphrasing, that God delivered me from sin and foolishness and sent me to preach to the Gentiles. This, my dear brothers and sisters, infuriated the Jews, and they decided, you are a Gentile lover. You deserve death. This is racism defined and personified. As long as Paul was delivered for Jew and Jew only, he was good for them. But when he allowed his conviction to recognize the humanity and need for spirituality in those outside of his race, they wanted him killed. And verse 20 tells us they began to take off their clothes. They began to kick dust in the air. And they brought him into the castle to be scourged. The Bible says they bound him with thongs. But the problem was that they did not understand who they had in bondage. And Paul let them know, you better check whether or not you can do to me what you are planning to do, because I am a citizen of Rome. I need to preach to about 21 people every now and then. You've got to check the enemy yourself and ask the enemy, do you know who I am? Do you have permission to do what you think you want to do to me? Why do you believe that you can harm me? You must don't know about me. You don't understand that I am a citizen, not of Rome, but I am royalty. I am a citizen of the kingdom of God. And Paul let them know, you're trying to condemn me, but I am uncondemned. And as I conclude, I would like for you to take this verse with you this week. If an enemy creeps up in your life, there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, to walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Tell your neighbor, I am not condemned. Tell your enemy, I am not condemned. The one who could have thrown the stone didn't throw it at me. He released me from condemnation. And when the centurion found out that Paul was a Roman citizen, the Bible says that the captain said, I paid a great price for my citizenship. Let him know, that's great for you. Yes, I'm a Hebrew, but I'm also a Roman. I didn't have to buy my freedom because I was born free. Preaching to enough people
Freedom didn't cost you one single thing. Why? It's only one reason. It's because Jesus paid it all.
At the beginning of this message, that tomorrow starts the first day of the second half of 2021. And somebody has been unjustly bound by some stuff that by the time you open your eyes tomorrow, church, somebody might have been living. By the time Paul says, you don't know who I am and what you're about to do. You're about to touch me and mess your whole life up. Somebody needs to look themselves in the mirror and tell every foolish problem in your life, you don't know who you're messing with. Don't try to bring sickness to my life, because I'm eradicating it with healing. Don't bring that poverty talk over here, because all we talk is wealth. Don't bring depression my way. I don't need no Zoloft. I've got the peace of God that surpasses all understanding. You, I hear you, Beyonce, must not know about me. You must not know about me. I'm a citizen of the kingdom, and you're going to have to lose me. Freedom. It's not in a piece of paper. It's not a document. It's not in a celebration. It's in Jesus. One has set free. It's free indeed. We sing it at every funeral. But it's not a funeral song. It's a song for daily life. I'm free. Praise the Lord, I'm free. No longer bound. I was born free. You got to loose me and let me go. Father, we thank you for the freedom that is available to us in Jesus Christ. There is nothing that can hold us from the purpose that you have designed for us to walk in. So God, we just ask and pray right now that you cause your people accelerated feet to walk into destiny and purpose. And we give you glory, honor, and praise right now. We thank you so much for your continued support. We anticipated, as the minister said, that people are going to be having cookouts. You may not be watching. You might catch this on the replay. We didn't give you anything less than what God gave us. And so we want to ask you to continue to support us as you have been with your prayers, with your texts, with your comments, your words of encouragement. Of course, we always reserve this time for the monetary appeal. I'm sure that you are seeing about four different ways that you can give on your screen. We want to highlight two of those. You can give via your Cash App, Cash Symbol, Cash Tag, Refuge, COGIC. You can text to give 77977, keyword Refuge Chesapeake. Thank you. God bless you. We'll see you next time.